Assalamualaikum viewers, welcome to the series of program called Organizational Behavior. Viewers, the basic aim of this program is to inculcate as much knowledge as possible of the subject called Organizational Behavior. And for this very purpose, we have a very vigilant team with us and the most exclusive team that I could have come up with. The subject expert is Mr. Fawad Bashir. He has expertise in the subject of management as well as he has done many researches related to this field. And we have a panel of students with us, Amna, Abdurrahim, Bilal and Alia. Thank you everyone for being with us. Sir, I would start with a very basic question, that why do we basically have to study the behavior?
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. As we all know that human behavior is a very complex phenomenon, and so far as our own personalities are concerned, at times we do not know that why we are behaving in a certain or particular manner. We have different moods, we have different attitudes, different attributes, different behaviors. So far as the behavior of an individual in an organization is concerned, it is again very complex phenomenon to be managed. So if we'll focus on the individual behavior, then we'll lead towards the group behavior and then the organizational behavior. Definitely it is a you can say basic brick. Mm-hmm. An individual is a brick of an organization. So if we try to get efficiency and effectiveness out of it, mm-hmm. definitely we have to focus this subject very much in an organization. Mm-hmm. So that we can lead those behaviors, individuals, to almost a standardized exactly. behavior or outcome, so that the consistent behavior will lead us towards consistent outcomes. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So this was about the behavior. That is, why is it important to study the behavior? If we go to the very beginning, how did the subject evolve?
Okay. Basically, this subject evolved from the very basic subject of management. Mm-hmm. And there are certain phases through which we like move toward this behavioral approach. The management as a science was taken by a certain scientist, Frederick Taylor, mm-hmm. Adam Smith, a known economist, and Frank and Lillian Gilbert. These were the people who were took the flag of scientific management. Mm-hmm. They took management as a science, mm-hmm. and they used scientific approach in it. Then came the era of bureaucracy, administrative approaches like by Mintzberg, the bureaucratic approach, the formalization. Mm-hmm. Then came the era of Maslow, certain psychologist, and they took it as that different individuals have different behaviors, different psychology. So behavior came into the scenario. Humanistic approach came into the scenario, and this was the era of like organizational behavior, human resource or human relation management, and then we moved upward. But definitely it took time to understand by the organization or managers that it is very important to manage individual behaviors, because they cannot be treated as robots. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Whenever we talk about an organization, especially in a setup where management is concerned, there is a term called managers, which I'm sure everyone will be aware of. What do basically these managers do in an organization?
Okay, as we're discussing the behavior, okay, of employees, and definitely those employees will be managed towards a particular direction to get a specific outcome by the people called managers. Mm-hmm. And managers are individuals who achieve goals through other people, and managerial activities are they make decisions, mm-hmm. they allocate resources, and they direct activities of others to attain those goals set by the overall organization. Okay.
Whereas organization is a consciously set organized social unit.
Yeah, right.
Well, sir, would you like to add upon it?
And basically, it is a consciously coordinated social unit composed of two or more people. Mm-hmm. That functions on a relatively continuous basis to achieve a common goal or set of mm-hmm. goals.
Exactly.
Okay, organization might be non-for-profit organization, mm-hmm. a social get-together or an organization. If you student go ahead and make a team or make a group so that you can get a job done, mm-hmm. you want to recreate yourself, and you'll you will collect funds, and you will go on a tour on a continuous basis. This will also be an organization. But here we are more concerned with a formal organization.
Okay. Amna, do you have a question?
Yes. Sir, what are the major functions performed by manager in an organization?
Okay. Basically, four major management functions are there: planning, organizing, leading, and controlling. And in planning, a process that includes defining goals, first of all, establishing the strategy that how to achieve the goals, and developing plans to coordinate activities. Mm-hmm. Definitely, this is the human part of it, that how to implement it through others. Okay? So in planning phase, we do these things, and then comes the organizing, determining what tasks are to be done, by whom, and how the tasks are to be coordinated or grouped, like structure is developed, and who reports to whom, and where decisions are to be made, whether centralized, decentralized, formalized, informalized. Then comes the leading, leadership, a function that includes motivating employees, directing others, mm-hmm. selecting the most effective communication channels, and resolving conflicts. Very important, which we'll discuss it later on as well.
Exactly. When you have mentioned it, viewers, the terms that we are mentioning are going to be discussed further in episodes, so that you can go in depth about the concepts. Very well.
And the last management function is controlling, monitoring activities to ensure they are being accomplished as planned and correcting any significant deviation. Mm-hmm. Okay, so whatever we have planned, we try to implement it, and then in controlling phase, we try to control the deviations, like the movements away from it.
Alia, would you like to add something here?
Sure. So far, we have discussed the functions of a manager.
Yeah.
So what could be the roles of manager in an organization?
Okay, we can say that these are the roles which manager perform to, you can say, perform those functions which mm-hmm. we have just discussed. Mm-hmm. And these roles as a manager are like, first is interpersonal role, and in interpersonal role, he or she will be dealing with others. Mm-hmm. Different, like individuals or employees.
At a one-to-one level.
Yeah, one-to-one or one-to-many.
Exactly.
As well. And it has certain sub roles, like figurehead, symbolic mm-hmm. head, required to perform number of routine duties or of a legal or social nature. Then leader, again an interpersonal role, responsible for the motivation and direction of employees. Mm-hmm. Then liaison. He or she will be liaisoning to maintain a network of within and outside the organization, as well on behalf of the organization. Second role is informational role. In this role, he will monitor the movement or flow of the information. In certain cases, he will be the disseminator of the information. Okay. He will spread it out.
Spread.
And certain roles, he will be like deal with other within and outside the organization as a spokesperson.
All right.
on behalf of the organization.
These are the things that a manager is supposed to be doing in an organization.
These are his or her roles in an organization.
And what are the decisional roles of a manager?
Yeah. This is the third one. Entrepreneur. That he will be like searching opportunities,
initiate,
yeah, disturbance handler if there are disturbances, resource allocator, and negotiator.
Mm-hmm.
As well. These are interpersonal roles.
All right.
Rather, these are different roles of a manager.
Students, would you like to add a question here? Abdurrahim, any question you would like to ask?
Sir, I have a question, that what are the management skills that leads organization in achieving their goals and objectives? Sir?
Okay, if we create a relationship, a person must have certain skills. Mm-hmm. To perform certain roles, and ultimately these will contribute towards those functions of mm-hmm. management. So these required skills are, first of all, technical skill, okay? The ability to apply specialized knowledge or expertise of someone towards something. Then human skills, the ability to work with, understand, and motivate other people, both individually and in a group.
Okay.
Then comes the conceptual skill, the mental ability to analyze and diagnose complex situation. Okay, so conceptual skill is required for managers to conceptualize the environment.
Mm-hmm. Decision making.
Yeah, decision making, to see the future, create
a
vision, and to see a bigger picture of everything. Mm-hmm. So that in a bigger construct, they will be placing individuals or tasks in a very better or
befitting
manner. Yeah.
Sir, is it safe to say that a manager is a leader then?
Contemporary literature says that manager might not be a leader, mm-hmm. but he or she should have or should possess leadership skills.
Mm-hmm.
So that he can perform all these activities in a better way.
Sound way. All right. Sir, what are basically the effective versus successful management skills? For example, some skills are effective, but there are some key points, or you can say there are some tips that say that are these are the successful management.
Very right. First of all, in traditional management, decision making, planning and controlling, these are functions used or performed by the manager. Then the communication part of it is exchanging routine information and processing paperwork, human resource management, motivating or managing conflicts, staffing and training, and then networking, socializing, politicizing and interacting with others. These four things will determine that how much proportion you will be allocating as a manager on each of them will determine that whether you are a successful or you are a routine manager. So we can refer to the slide that average manager, like they focus 32% on their traditional management, 19% to networking, 29% on communication and 20% on like human resource management. Effective managers are like they increased their you can say proportion of communication, that is 44%. But successful managers, they increase their networking, 48% of their overall activities. So this is the human part of it. Okay, you have to interact, you have to make a network as if we as a team, we are like going through a series of lectures. If we'll build a better team, definitely like we'll be like producing better results. But if networking will not be strong amongst all of us, definitely we cannot produce better results.
Exactly.
Okay? So successful managers, you can say, focus more towards the human side or networking side of
interpersonal
it.
Skills.
Yeah.
So I have a question. We discuss about the skills, roles. My question is, what are the disciplines contributing to the field of organizational behavior?
Okay, so far as this subject is concerned, it is very broad in scope because we are talking here about like management, we are talking about managers, individuals, groups, teams,
behavior,
socialization. First of all, what is organizational behavior as a subject? A field of study that investigates the impact that individuals, groups and structure have on behavior within organization for the purpose of applying such knowledge toward improving the organizational
effectiveness.
Okay. So far as different again concepts are concerned, again organizational behavior has two dimensions, intuitive dimension and as a systematic study. Intuition is a feeling not necessarily supported by research. Systematic study is looking at relationships, attempting to attribute causes and effects amongst different variables and drawing conclusions based on scientific evidence. Okay?
Further elaborating, intuition is something that you get from within.
From within,
whereas
yeah.
the systematic way is when you have
very
experiences
right.
and on the basis of those experiences you reach certain conclusions.
Okay, the first ever contributing discipline is psychology. Definitely here we are more concerned with the individual, the science that seeks to measure, explain and sometimes change the behavior of humans and other animals.
And if I'm not wrong, sir, psychology is a very impactful field of study,
very right.
whereas
very right.
organization behavior is concerned.
Very right, a major one.
A major one.
Psychology and OB field will like contributing in case of learning, motivation, personality, emotions, perception, training, leadership, satisfaction, dissatisfaction, performance appraisal, selection, and stress, conflicts, so on and
certain
so forth.
Things.
Okay, so this is individual side of the subject. Then comes the sociology. Definitely here we are more concerned with
groups.
The study of people in relation to their fellow human being. So here contributing like elements will be group dynamics, work teams, communication, power, conflict, and intergroup behavior. And the other dimension is formal organization theory. Definitely it will be originated from sociology. Organizational technology, change and culture. And these will be like focusing towards the systems and group side of an organization.
All right.
Then there is a subject of social psychology. Again, it's combination of definitely the
different
previous
groups.
Course. Yeah. An area within psychology that blends concepts from psychology and sociology and
exactly.
that focuses on the influence of people on one another
exactly.
as a social construct because organization is also a social construct as well. And social psychology will contribute towards behavioral changes. Very important because we have to change at times mold behaviors towards like a specific outcome. Then attitude change, communication, group processes and group decision making. Okay.
And it is not to be forgotten that these three disciplines are to be taken separately into account.
Definitely. But we'll when we'll talk about the subject OB, we will take them simultaneously and
incorporating them into different theories and different concepts.
Very right. And then comes the subject of anthropology, which is related with the study of human beings and their activities. And here we'll be talking about like comparative values, comparative attitudes, cross-cultural analysis, because in this scenario of international business, or you can say this is a boundaryless, a globalized era. So here the role of anthropology is very important.
Because they say that the world has become a global village, Earth has become a global village.
And then we'll study organizational culture, organizational environment, and this will lead us towards development of certain systems of an organization.
All right.
Okay. Then I think the last one is political science.
Yes.
Okay. The study of the behavior of individuals and groups within a political environment. Mm-hmm. Because when there is a power or power structure, there comes the role of political science, where we have to manage the power and power structure.
This means that within an organization, politics are also there.
Yeah, it is there, positively or negatively, both. And political science will contribute like in conflict resolution, interorganizational like politics or power structure and management of it, and this will again contribute toward development of the organizational system.
Now viewers, here it is important to notice that all the fields that we have just discussed are important to take into account, because these are the things that are being studied in an organization, and these are the things that form an person's behavior within an organization.
Very right. Okay. So these are like major contributing disciplines, but there are certain other factors, contingency variables as well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Like situational factors, variables that moderate the relationship between two or more other variables and improve the correlation. But they can like rather improving it, they can like move it other way around as well. But in this field of study, we will make a construct, make a relationship, and definitely we will go for certain intervening or moderating or mediating variables so that we can improve the overall behavior or efficiency or effectiveness of an organization or individual.
So what is the literal meaning of the word contingency?
Contingency means the current, the situational, the existing
one.
Yeah, contemporary.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah.
What are the major challenges and opportunities of organizational behavior?
Okay, first of all, the latest scenario as we have just discussed, the globalization.
Mm-hmm.
Because world is changing like anything, and change is the only constant.
Exactly.
Okay? So we have to respond that, first of all, then managing the workforce diversity, because when we are working across cultures, across the borders, definitely a diverse workforce is there, which is a major challenge as well. Improving quality and productivity, because this is a very competitive world.
Definitely.
So far as the corporate or business side, business setups are concerned. So we have to like improve quality on a very continuous basis and improve productivity at the same moment and reduce the cost. Then responding to the labor shortage.
Mm.
Skilled labor is not there.
Exactly.
Definitely you have to incorporate trainings, developments, human resource development. And this is again a field related to the organizational behavior. Improving customer services, because again we are talking about customers.
Exactly.
And
yes.
They are being dealt with or through the employees. And here comes the role of behavior as well. Then improving people's skills towards achieving all of the above. Empowering people, because as we have just discussed, that there are certain contingential situational variables. To handle those situational variables, if employees are not properly empowered to handle like such situations, definitely those situations will be like lost, or your opportunities will be lost, or threat will overcome us. Coping with temporariness, again change is there, you have to be very vigilant and quick against responding then. And whenever you'll be like dealing with the change, you have to again redesign your setup, restructurize the thing, and temporariness in the current system.
Because there are some people who have a lot of resistance towards accepting change.
Then stimulation, innovation and change, again, you can say outcome of the today's innovative environment. Helping employees balance work-life conflicts, again, a very important thing.
Mm-hmm.
Because nowadays we think that human beings are machines, and the jobs are stressful like anything. Families and social lives are almost finished.
Exactly.
So this is again the question revived again, that we have to create a balance between the work life, work and social life of employee, so that they can be more productive. Because the literature says that the future of the organizations are that they will exist only for the employees, and rest will take care of itself.
Okay.
If you will be taking care of your employees, they will take care of everything.
That if the employees are the assets of an organization.
Yeah, they are.
Because definitely if a person is having job satisfaction, he or she would be more motivated towards his or her work.
Very good. And the last, not least, will be like is improving ethical behavior of the employees. It is again a today's requirement.
Exactly. It should be on the top, because nowadays ethics are going like anywhere. All right, sir. The next thing that I would want to ask is that what is the basic organization behavior model, or what is it? There are certain stages involved in it.
Basically, when we try to like group all these things in a systematic way in a model, we'll be dealing with first of all the individual level, then we'll form certain departments or groups, and then we'll be talking about the organizational system level. This model is an model. What is a model? Model is an abstraction of reality, a simplified representation of some real world phenomenon. Okay. So simplest is the individual will lead towards certain groups. Groups will lead towards an organization, and these three levels are interrelated.
Okay.
And these are like covered in the scope of organizational
behavior.
Then we seek certain relationships. There are certain dependent variables, there are certain independent variables. Dependent variables are those required outcomes in a very, you can say, organization. These variables like job satisfaction, productivity, efficiency, effectiveness, like these things. And there are certain variables on which these dependent variables depend upon. These are independent variables, as we have already discussed.
That affect the dependent variables.
These might be dependent variables are like productivity. A performance measure that includes effectiveness and efficiency.
Effectiveness is basically the achievement of those goals.
Very right. And efficiency is the ratio of effective output to the input required to achieve it. If I rephrase it, efficiency and effectiveness. Effectiveness is doing the right things.
Yes.
And efficiency is doing the things
right.
In a right.
Exactly.
Manner. Okay. These are like dependent variable. Then absenteeism, the failure to report to the work. Definitely, it is very much related with the satisfaction or motivation of an employee. Then turnover, the voluntary and involuntary, permanent withdrawal from an organization. These five variables are dependent variables of this model, and these are the variables which should be like controlled and towards the positive side. Okay.
And these basically these variables are mostly employee based.
Yeah, these are employee based, but definitely if organization is producing such a conducive environment, then these will be positive. And another you can say variable might be like organizational citizenship
behavior.
Yes, sir.
Discretionary behavior that is not part of an employee's formal job requirement, but that nevertheless promotes the effective functioning of the organization. Like, if any one of us is being a citizen of any community or country, will be doing his or her obligation, legal obligation, he is a good citizen, but the best one will be who will be doing over and above it.
Beyond
their basic responsibility. Same is the case with the organizational citizenship behavior. He or she will be doing above or beyond those required or obligatory duties.
Within an organization.
Yeah, yeah. Then another variable is job satisfaction.
It is a very major variable. Major,
yeah. A general attitude towards one's job, the difference between the amount of reward workers receive and the amount they believe they should receive. Okay. Again, this
perception
is the role of this is the role of
expectations.
Expectation and perception.
Here comes the behavior of a person.
Yeah, very right. Then the independent variables.
All right.
Okay. The presumed cause of some change in the dependent variable. Okay. So here we have just discussed individual level variable. At the individual level, we'll be dealing with his or her decision making, style of decision making, perception, attitude, behavior, the psychology side of
exactly.
it. At the group level, we'll be dealing with certain teams, we'll be dealing with inter or intra group relationships, we'll be dealing with certain conflicts, and definitely this will be like an outcome of your sociology side of the subject. then social psychology and other subjects will be contributing toward organization system level variables, where we'll be dealing with like the individuals, then groups, different departments, and at the system level. Okay, and on the basis of these things, we'll be forming the culture, the system, the structure, and overall values of any organization.
All right. Sir, the final question of today's episode is that the things that we have studied or we are going to study in this particular subject, can these be beneficial or helpful to these students when they'll go further in the organizations working over there? Because some of them can be the managers there, some of them will be the employees there, some of them will be the maybe the heads of those organizations.
Okay, so far as this subject is concerned, it is not only necessary, I would say it is a must. It is one of the core courses studied in any business school. Because being a manager, as the definition is, that we have to get the job done by others efficiently and effectively. And if being a manager, we are not able enough to deal with, to understand the behaviors of others, their, you can say, the personality differences, differences in personality, and our interpersonal skill is not strong. And we don't know how to deal with like behaviors or within the group or outside the group or whatsoever it is. We cannot manage the conflict or all these variables, like they'll be producing such employees who will be less satisfied, turnover will be increased in such organizations in which this is not a consideration. So it is your absenteeism, turnover. So it is one of the very major areas in which students must have an expertise.
All right. With this, we come to the end of the first episode of the series of program called Organization Behavior. Viewers, it is very important to understand and to keep in mind the things that our experts and everything that has been discussed, the content that is basically of the program. And in today's episode, we have discussed what basically behavior is all about, what managers do in an organization, what are the helping or the fields that are contributing towards the field of organizational behavior. And last but not the least, we also discussed the basic organization behavior model. In the coming episodes, we will go in depth and obviously we'll touch every area that comes under the field of study. I'd like to say keep watching our programs and try to take out and try to infer as much as possible from this series of program. Thank you very much. Thank you very much all for being with us. Allah Hafiz.